against me. I'm surrounded on all sides, but I've heard you can part the waters. So in your name, come and turn the tides. I'm staring at this mountain, no chance I'm getting through, but I've heard they can melt before you. So in your name, I'm asking it to move. Let that
It is finished, it is done. Yeah, I heard you told death it was over. So in your name, I'll claim this fight is won.
Lift up your heads, O you gates. Lift them up, you ancient doors, that the King of glory may come in. Who is he, this King of glory? The Lord Almighty. He is the King of glory. You're most welcome to stand.
Unhasting and silent as light, no wanting nor wasting, thou rulest in might. Thy justice like mountains high soaring above, thy clouds which are fountains of goodness and love. To all life thou givest, to both great and small, in all life thou livest, the true life of all. We blossom and flourish as leaves on the tree, and wither and perish, but not changeth thee. Great Father of glory, pure Father of light, thine angels adore thee, all veiling sight. All praise we would render, or help us to see, 'tis only the splendor of light hideth thee. How great a cast that lay between us, how high the mountains I could not climb. In desperation I turned to heaven and spoke your name into the light. Then through the darkness your loving kindness tore through the shadows of my soul. The work is finished, the end is written. Jesus Christ, my living hope. Who could imagine so great a mercy? What heart could fathom such boundless grace? The God of ages stepped down from glory to wear my sin and bear my shame. The cross has spoken, I am forgiven. The King of kings calls me his own. Beautiful Savior, I'm yours forever. grip on me. You have broken every chain. There's salvation in your name, Jesus Christ, my living hope. Alleluia. Praise the one who set me free. Alleluia. Death has lost its grip on me. You have broken every chain. There's salvation in your name, Jesus Christ, my living hope. Then came the morning that sealed the promise. Your buried body began to breathe. Out of the silence, the roaring lion declared, the grave has no claim on me. Then came the morning that sealed the promise. Your buried body began to breathe. Out of the silence, yours is the victory. Alleluia. Praise the one who set me free. Alleluia. Death has lost its grip on me. You have broken every chain. There's salvation in your name, Jesus Christ, my living hope.
Less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I did not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly laid on Jesus' name. On Christ the solid rock I stand. All other ground is sinking sand. All other ground is sinking sand. When darkness veils his lovely face, I rest on his unchanging grace. In every high and stormy gale, my anchor holds within the veil. On Christ the solid rock I stand. All other ground is sinking sand. All other ground is sinking sand. His oath, his covenant, his blood support me in the overwhelming flood. When all around my soul gives way, he then is all my hope and stay. On Christ the solid rock I stand. All other ground is sinking sand. All other ground is
sinking sand. When he shall come with trumpet sound, oh, may I then in him be found, dressed in his righteousness alone, faultless to stand before the throne. On Christ the solid rock I stand. All other ground is sinking sand. All other ground is sinking sand.
I believe, I believe, I believe. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and was buried. The third day he rose from the dead, he ascended into heaven, and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Good morning, church. I'm doing a little filling in for Heather. Someone decided to go on vacation. Craziness. Okay, so we're doing Blessing the Backpacks today. So if you are a kid, if you're a teacher, if you're an educator, if you're an administrator, and you have a backpack, or in my case, because I'm a student, I have my laptop. Whoops. Because I'm an online student, so this is how I do all my work. So I brought my laptop up here to be blessed. So does anybody else have something to bring up? Aiden, did you bring your backpack? That's okay. We're gonna pretend that we have all of the school supplies and all of the backpacks and all of their coats and those first day of school lunch boxes and all of those things that we can put blessings on out into the world. So would y'all help me with that? Okay. Today we have gathered before us backpacks to be carried to and from school by the children and youth gathered here. These backpacks will contain work to be done, work that's been returned, turn that work in, books to be studied, tools to complete homework, notebooks, pencils, pens, crayons, rulers, scissors, glue sticks, and other items used for schoolwork will find their way in and out of these backpacks and our classrooms. Some days, so much stuff will fill these backpacks that you, the student, may find it difficult to walk. Other days, they may be light and nearly empty. But on each and every day, these backpacks represent work required of the students gathered. And in every aspect of our life, we bring these before God for blessings at this time. Will you pray with me? Gracious God, we lift to you today these students. They stand here ready to receive your blessings, and they commit themselves to study and to learning in the school year ahead. We ask your blessings on each of them. Further, we ask your blessings on these backpacks, these school supplies, these lunch boxes, that they will hold the schoolwork of each student and will be carried from home to school and back again. As these students carry these backpacks, may they be reminded of the love and care of this congregation that surrounds them each and every school day. We pray as well for the teachers and administrators in our schools. May they also be sustained by your blessing. May they be reminded that this congregation embraces their call to teaching and learning and surrounds them with love and care as well. We pray in the name of Jesus, who we seek to follow day by day. Amen. So since we've got school starting back again, we're going to start back with Purpose and with Shine. We're going to meet on Thursday nights. Shine's going to meet in the Wesley room and in the gym. And the crossover is where Purpose is going to hang out. Purpose is our college ministry. And we're just looking to build a community. And so I might need your help with that. We want our college students to feel like this is a place where they can grow, but also they can make mistakes like we did when we were that age. But we're not going to be there to judge them. We're going to be there to pick them back up and to love them. And so if you will pray just in general for Purpose and for Shine as we start back up in this school year. Thanks.
Good morning. We just got back from conference. That was Friday and Saturday, and had a wonderful time there. And we'll be letting you know all the wonderful things that happened as time goes on. And so we look forward to that. But today, I want to talk to you a little bit before we pray about something that's I think is exciting. You've heard that story about don't put new wine in old wineskins? You have heard that, right? It's in the gospel. Jesus said that. Okay, good. So you're familiar with that. Well, the church is in the midst of change right now, specifically the United Methodist Church. But God is going to be doing some new stuff. Now, by that, I don't mean that the gospel is going to change or that you don't need to seek forgiveness and be cleansed by the blood of Jesus Christ and become a new creation, okay? That never changes. That's always the same. You know, it's kind of like the woman who was caught in the act of adultery and Jesus wrote in the dirt and if you haven't sinned, go ahead and throw the first stone. He looks up and, woman, where are your accusers? Well, they're not here. Well, neither do I. But go and sin no more. Okay, we always leave off that last part, you know. So change the way you think, change the way you act, and get your life together. And so So God is going to be doing some new stuff here in our midst. And basically, it's just a new way of telling the story of Jesus Christ and a new way of fullness of the Holy Spirit. And so that means that God is... Can you believe that during the COVID thing, God was working in our hearts and lives? And we're all going, we need a change, God. And he goes, well, that's good because I'm bringing one. Okay? And so in that time, in this last year, God was working in our lives and he was giving us building in us the ability to take on that new wine that he's going to be pouring out. Y'all looking puzzled at me like you haven't heard this kind of talk before. So, God wants to do a new thing here, and he wants to use you. And so he's got some new wine, and he wants to pour it in some new wineskins. Okay? Is that all right? It's going to have to be because that's what God's doing, okay? So I hope you that you'll be willing and open to that. And we'll talk more about the changes that are coming in the Methodist Church and all that sort of stuff. We have some home meetings so that we can talk about that and let you know what's happening. And 'cause it's important for you to know and for me to hear what you have to say about all that stuff. Okay? All right, now we better pray. Lord, we just want to thank you that you love us so much, God. That, Father, you're doing a new thing and your zeal is going to accomplish it. And that you have prepared us for this new thing, and that you're pouring new wine into us even now. Because, Lord, you've given us a new wineskin, a new way to receive what you're doing. And so, Lord, we just want to thank you for that and give you praise and thanks, and just let you know that we're willing, Father, to follow your Spirit and you and your Son, Jesus Christ, wherever it is that you want to take us. And that, Lord, we're going to lay down ourselves and get the me out of me and let you come in. Picking up our cross, dying daily, however you want to say that, Father, help us understand that we surrender. And in the surrender, Father, is our victory. And so we thank you and give you praise for all that you're doing in our midst. How you're wrapping your arms of love around us and holding us close in times of need and trouble and difficulties. And how, Father, that you are working to encourage our hearts and strengthen us for the ministry that you have for this church and this city. And so, Father, we give you praise and thanks through Jesus Christ, our Savior. We pray for our nation, Father, and we pray that justice and righteousness would sweep over our land. And in our elected leaders, Father, who are your servants and ours, that your Spirit would direct the course of their hearts, Father. There are things that are going on that we don't like. And so we come to you, Lord, and ask for righteousness and justice. And Father, we lay our cause before you. And so, Lord, help us to stand up and call for that in our homes, in our city, to get a hold of our councilman and mayor and let them know how we feel, to be bold and strong about the desire for righteousness and justice in this city. And so, Lord, we thank you for that, and we give you praise. Lord, we pray for our first responders. And Lord, they are busier than ever with this COVID variant. But Father, you are the Alpha and the Omega. And so we come to you because you are the God who heals us. And so, Lord, we claim that healing in the name of Jesus Christ. We speak that healing to all we meet in the name of Jesus Christ. And we thank you, Father, for your love and your watch care over us. And Lord, we give you praise and thanks. We remember, Father, that those who are in our armed forces, and we lift them up, and those who are in this regrouping in Afghanistan, and just that nation, Lord, and all that's going on there, and the nations and the United Methodists all around this world, Father. We lift up the church as it's going through changes and ask that your Spirit lead and guide, and that your men and women stand up and demand righteousness. And Lord, we thank you for that. And Lord, we just give you the praise. Move in our hearts. Make us, Lord, the heathen are raging against your holy child, Jesus Christ. And so give us boldness to speak and spread the word of Christ, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Lord, we just thank you for that. And we lift up this prayer, Father, that we try to pray every Sunday. Give it new meaning in our lives about Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. So let us pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. I'm excited. I don't know about you. So I just want to say, you've been so faithful in your giving, and we just want to say thank you. Keep up the good work. And there's an offering box in the back or here in the front. On your way out, if you'll just put that in there, that'll be great. And Steve's going to minister to us. All right.
An angel stood with flaming sword at Eden's darkened gate. The frightened family faced a world now filled with Satan's hate. These fallen children God so loved were lost in fear alone. Now love would spare no cost to bring them home. Love found a can hold the price love chose to pay. All hope was gone till Easter's dawn. We are free because love found a one nation rose to bring one man, a virgin would conceive. A man who died, then rose with life for all who will believe. For every child of Adam's race that longs to leave despair, the road that leads us home to love is there. Love found a way. Love found a way. And our hearts can hold the price love chose to pay. All hope was gone till Easter's dawn. We are free because love found a
brother. Amen. Hallelujah. Aren't you excited that love found a way? Amen. Amen. Well, last week I asked you a question. Did you think about it at all? 100%, all right? Is God in everything? Is God in everything? Is God in everything? Convince me. Is God in everything? Well, you're getting better. All right, well, there's a number of verses in the Bible that talk about that very thing, and I'm going to share a couple of them. I love this verse. I have to repent often, but I love this verse. Do not be anxious about anything. Yeah, okay, I'm in the right place. But in everything, by prayer and petition, with thanksgiving, present your requests to God, and the peace of God, which transcends all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. Or there's this one. We're not to be anxious about anything because our Father cares for us. And we're not to take revenge. Oh, listen to that. We're not to take revenge because our Father has charged himself with our defense. God is for us. Who can be against us? Yeah, so do not fear, for I am with you. And do not be dismayed, for I am your God. I will strengthen you and help you. I will uphold you with my righteous right hand. Or then there's this one. Fear not. For I have redeemed you, I have summoned you by name. God summoned you by name. That's pretty scary some days, isn't it? Can you imagine that? It's God. Yeah. I've summoned you by name. You are mine. And when you pass through the waters, I will be with you. And when you pass through the rivers, they will not sweep over you. And when you walk through the fire, you will not be burned. The flames will not set you ablaze, for I am the Lord your God, the Holy One, your Savior. And there's lots of other verses like that. Well, we're going to look at this question of is God in everything through the lens of Romans chapter 8, starting in verse 26. In the same way, the Spirit helps us in our weakness. We do not know what we ought to pray for, but the Spirit himself intercedes for us with groans that words cannot express. And he who searches our hearts knows the mind of the Spirit, because the Spirit intercedes for the saints in accordance with God's will. And we know that in all things, God works for the good of those who love him, who have been called according to his purpose. For those God foreknew, he also predestined to be conformed to the likeness of his Son, that he might be the firstborn among many brothers and sisters. And those he predestined, he also called. And those he called, he also justified. And those he justified, he also glorified. It's the word of God for the people of God. Will you pray with me and for me? May the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be pleasing in your sight, O Lord, my rock and my redeemer. Amen. You see, in those verses we learn several things, but three things in particular. God himself provides what we need. God provides what we need. And we are to wait eagerly and patiently and expectantly for God to do what he said he was going to do. Now, in the midst of that, the Spirit helps us pray. And God promises to oversee everything for our good. And he does these things according to his unbreakable plan for us. That's pretty exciting. God's got an unbreakable plan for each and every one of us. And the goal of that plan is to get you into heaven. No rejoicing over that? You're going to make it. Okay? So, you see, hope sustains us in our time of trouble. There's a couple verses that I found. You know, in Joshua, it was the valley of Achor where they stoned Achan. That meant the valley of trouble. And then Hosea over there, he's prophesying and he goes, look, he's speaking for the Lord and he says, I, the Lord God Almighty, will make the valley of trouble a door of hope. And then Isaiah picks it up and he says, the valley of trouble will be a resting place. Now I just look at the last year and we were there. But you see, it's a door of help. It's a place where we get reformed, reshaped. It's a resting place. Now, you know this psalm probably by heart, but it talks about that very idea of God making the place of trouble a door of hope and a resting place. The Lord is my shepherd. Someone said, and I don't want any more. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not be in want. He leads me down, lays me down in green pastures. He leads me beside quiet waters. He restores my soul. He guides me in paths of righteousness for his name's sake. You see, you are the ambassador of God and you represent God in this world. And so he's going to take care of his name. And so he's leading you for his name's sake. And even though I walk through this valley of trouble, the shadow of death, I will fear no evil for you are with me. And that's what we have to understand, that God is with us. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. Well, the rod beats up the predators and the staff supports us. God is saying, I'm going to take care of the things that are troubling and I'm going to support you with my outstretched hand. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. Can you imagine that? Sitting down to a banquet table in front of all the people who have been ornery towards you? Yeah. In the presence of my, you anoint my head with oil, my cup overflows. Surely goodness and mercy will follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. He's really saying, look, I'm going to dwell in the presence of God forever. That's exciting. Tell your face. Not only so, we rejoice in the hope of the glory of God, but not only so, but we also rejoice in our troubles because we know that troubles produce perseverance and perseverance character and character hope, and hope does not disappoint us because God has poured out his love into our hearts by the Holy Spirit whom he has given to us. And in the same sustaining way, the Spirit helps us in our weaknesses. Now, weaknesses, yeah. You have limitations because you're a human, right? The Spirit's job is to help you with that stuff. Poke you in the ribs and say, hey, you shouldn't be doing that. You know, kind of, I was talking to somebody about, you know, they were going to be the cheerleaders today and get up and shout and scream, and they laughed at me and said, my mama said if I moved in church, she'd pinch my ear so hard it'd fall off my head. Well, that's what the Holy Spirit does when you're not behaving. Gives you a good pinch. And some of us go, quit pinching me. Thanks for that help, sister. The Spirit helps us. Our limitations because of our human nature. And because of these limitations, sometimes we don't know how we should pray. We're just kind of like, ah! Have you ever felt that way? Okay, I just want to make sure I was talking to the right people. We just don't know. Our insight into God's will and what are you doing? It's far short of perfect. We have no crystal balls because God said that wasn't a thing we should be doing. Okay? And so in many situations, we're just puzzled. We know that we're supposed to be doing something. We're not sure what it is we're supposed to do and exactly how we're supposed to pray. But the Holy Spirit comes to our aid and intercedes on our behalf with groans. Have you ever groaned? I remember one time I was a family in the church when we were up in Tucumcari, which is, you know, you can't, it's not the end of the world, but you see it from there. And their son was in an automobile accident in Lubbock and died, and it was awful. And I just was in there just... Finally, my secretary came in and said, you've been groaning a lot. What is it you're supposed to be doing? So I got in the car and went to Lubbock. But, I wasn't sure. And so we had to reach out. And, the funny thing about all that, it changed the whole perspective of the church. Because they thought, hey, we got a pastor who cares about us. And things just changed. That happens here when those groans happen and you hear the Holy Spirit and follow. That's why this church is 140 years old. Because people have heard the groaning of the Holy Spirit in their hearts and have been obedient. You see, he comes to our aid and intercedes on our behalf with groans and words that cannot be expressed. He may even give us a language to speak in that we don't understand. They actually have a name for that. It's called glossolalia. Did you know that? That's speaking in tongues. That's the theological word. But that can happen. In this time of expectant suffering, the Spirit's intercession is one support. He stands in the gap for us. Now, we have another one. Who is the person who condemns? Look, Christ Jesus, who died for us, more than that, who was raised to life, is at the right hand of God and is also interceding for us. Hey, we got an in with the boss. So not only is the Holy Spirit dealing with us down here, but Jesus is up there talking to Dad, saying, hey, did you know that? Did you know that Jesus called him Dad? Did you know that? Abba Pater, Daddy. That's the kind of relationship that God wants to have with us. And then there's another thing. It's called the providence of God. Have you ever heard of that? Okay. Providence is a word we use to describe God's beneficial rule over the events of all of life. And this verse in 8:28, and we know that in all things God works for the good of those who love him, who are called according to his purpose, is one of the greatest biblical descriptions of that very providence. Christians of every age have found comfort in this wonderful promise. Now, look, from God's perspective, okay, let's... From God's perspective, good has to be defined in spiritual terms. The ultimate good is God's glory. And he is glorified when we, his children, live as Christ did, conformed to the likeness of his Son, and attain the glory he has destined us for. God is glorified when you make it into heaven. Because that was his plan. Now look, anybody out there ever suffer in any way? okay, and the rest of you aren't telling me. Look, God uses that suffering to build Christian character in us, to conform us to Christ, and prepare us for that final glory. What he promises in 8:28 then is, now listen to this, not every difficult experience will lead to something good in life. The good God may have in mind may involve the next life. Now, of course, you know that's the resurrected body in heaven, right? It's not reincarnation, just in case somebody was wondering. Okay. And look, he might take you out of a secure, well-paying job to shake you out of the materialistic lifestyle that does not honor biblical priorities. Ouch. God would rather have you in heaven than have lots. And so if he needs to do something to help you, he certainly will. I mean, he may want to set us free from a relationship or an engagement, because he wants to use us in a ministry that would be difficult or impossible for a married person. And now just remember that in sharing in Christ's suffering, we eventually will be able to share in his glory as well. So I'm going to tell you a real story. Well, no, it's a true story. How's that? That's better. My beloved back there, 45 years this month, she's put up with me. The Pope has considered making her a saint. But when we first got to know each other, she had been a Christian a lot longer than I had, but she goes, you know, you're taking the place of Jesus in my life, so let's stop here. And then, of course, she was in college at the time, so she went off and student taught someplace, I don't know, and got a job teaching school, and it wasn't until later on. It was probably, I don't know, 9-10 months later when we finally got hooked back together again, because God had to be the priority in our lives, even though we love each other dearly. Now look, I'm not saying that material blessings cannot be included in the good of Romans 8:28. You know, as the scriptures make clear, God delights to give his children good things in this life as well as in the next. Amen? Yeah. And essentially, Romans 8:28 promises that nothing will touch our lives that is not under the control and direction of our loving Heavenly Father. And everything we do and say, and everything people do to us and say about us, and every experience we will ever have, all are sovereignly used by God for our good. We'll not always understand how the things we experience work to good, and we certainly will not always enjoy them. But we do know nothing comes into our lives God does not allow and use for his own good purposes. And it is only God, through his Spirit, who can in all things work for our good. In this context, the good is especially the final glory to which God has destined us. But it also includes the benefits of being a child of God in this life. Those who love God is simply a way of describing all of God's people. It's not a qualification of the promise where, if I love God enough, look. You remember that story about Peter, how he denied Jesus, and then in the Gospel of John later on, Jesus is talking to Peter, and he goes, hey, look, do you love me, dude? Well, yeah, you know I love you. And actually, you know, if you go into the Greek, Jesus is saying, you know, do you really love me? And he's going, yeah, I like you. And then he asks him again, do you really love me? Well, yeah, I like you. And then the third time, finally he says, do you like me? Lord, you know all things. You know I like you. Because in Greek, they have all kinds of different words for love. And so our English translation gets lost there. But, you know, that's, he finally, yes, God, I do like you. And Jesus commissioned him to go and lead the group of the knotheads. You know? You see, God's plan for us begins in a decision to enter into relationship with us. You see, it's not that we want to know God, because we don't. So it was that God wanted to know us, and so he put it this way, for God so loved the world. And in the Gospel of John, when it talks about the world, it talks about those people who don't even like him, who are mad at him, who are rebelling against him, who are doing everything they can do to get rid of him. But God loved him. Just like he loved me and you. And so he gave his one and only son, and that whoever believes in him should never perish, but have everlasting life. And then I love verse 17 almost as much as verse 16, because verse 17 says this, look, God did not send his son into the world to condemn the world. He sent Jesus Christ into the world to save us. You know, and then of course at the beginning of chapter 8 in Romans, there is therefore now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. And so you see, this entering into this relationship, you know, we have to respond to his gracious invitation. And then this leads in turn to a decision to predestine us. That is to direct us to a particular goal. And then Paul spells out the goal. To be conformed to the likeness of the Son. Christian means little Christ. And so you're supposed to be out there in the world being Jesus. Did you know that? Yeah. As the Father has sent me, so send I you. And then he breathed on him and said, receive the Holy Ghost because you're going to need help. That was free. The last transformation in our Christian life is to be conformed to Christ's own glorious body. It's the resurrection. Look, it's the bodily resurrection. It's not some metaphorical, mystical something. It's not some vapor. It's your body coming out of the grave and being made new and being like Jesus. Now, I've read a few books about people who've been to heaven. The good news is we all get to be young, okay? Hallelujah. And skinny. You know, so the other thing is, who's going to care? We're going to be with Jesus. But anyway, that's the last transformation. When the trumpet sounds and the dead in Christ rise, and then we who are alive and remain go up and meet them in the air, and there we're ever going to be with Jesus. So encourage one another with this thought. Our citizenship is in heaven, and we eagerly await a Savior from there. We're looking forward to that resurrection. If you're not excited about that, get excited now. Don't wait. It's good preaching, Brother Scott. And who is that Savior? The Lord Jesus Christ, who by the power that enabled him to bring everything under his control will transform our lowly bodies so that they will be like his glorious body. how great is the love of the Father has lavished on us, that we should be called children of God. And that's what we are. Children of God. Dear friends, now we are children of God, and what we will be has not yet been made known, but we know that when he appears, we shall be like him, for we shall see him as he is, face to face. And everyone who has this hope in him, Jesus Christ, purifies themselves just as he is pure. You see, he appeared so that he might take away our sins. You see, God enters relationship with us so that we may attain the goal of glorification. Our calling is God's effective summoning us into relationship with himself through Christ. We have to enter into that friendship with Jesus Christ as Savior and Lord. Yes, Jesus, I like you. That's about all I got right now, but we'll work on it. And he'll help us. And so we enter in and we start. And after setting us on the road to the goal of conformity to Christ, so it's a process. It doesn't happen overnight. Well, it kind of does, but we don't act that way for a while. Okay? It's a process. And God in his grace and by his Spirit reaches out and brings us into his own people. We become the people of God, and then he justifies us. Now, that's a theological word that means just. He makes you just as if you had never sinned. Wow, that is so cool. By the death and resurrection of Jesus Christ, we are made a new creation, and it's just as if we had never sinned or broken God's commands. That's what he does for us. Declaring us, are you ready? The judge declares us innocent. And as the capstone, God glorifies us, makes us like Christ, and gives us a resurrected body. Isn't that cool? We can go through walls and just kind of appear. Hey. These are all actions happening in the past. It's a language thing. It's the aorist. It means this event happened in the past, and the effect of that goes on forever. Okay? So, what happened in the past? The death and resurrection of Jesus Christ, an actual historical event, and the effects of that when we enter into relationship with Christ go on forever. You see, as we enter relationship with God, the old life is washed away by the blood, and we get a new life in Jesus Christ. We're a new creation. The old is gone. The new has come. Take off the old self, just like taking off clothes before you get ready to jump in the shower. And then put on the new self in Christ Jesus. And here's the cool thing. You see, we all get caught up in this, but don't. From God's perspective, he sees that as a done deal. So quit looking at yourself the way you look at yourself in the midst of your struggles, and start looking at yourself the way God looks at you, the image of Christ. Now that's exciting. And it wasn't in my notes. God has already made the decision before the creation of the world to glorify everyone that he has justified. And here's the main point. to assure us as believers, God has a plan he is unfolding. One providing fully for our future glory. God wants us to have a renewed sense of assurance. Look, the world has gone crazy. God wants you to stand strong and be assured so that you can be the one who says, I have good news for you. You see, because God who began a good work in you will indeed bring it to completion in the day of Christ Jesus. As justified believers, we can be confident that we will experience full salvation because God's love for us and the work of Christ and the ministry of the Holy Spirit. That's all I got to say. Amen. So, yeah, if you want to come on down to the altar, they are open. I know you know Jesus, and you know, I'm a sinner if I walk down to the altar. How about you're a saint who's coming down to say howdy to the Father? Okay? That's the reason to come on down. And just, you know, those who are nervous about that, just rejoice where you are. But don't let people not come. Okay? So, this is awful. Just bear with me. Come on down. The price is right.
Prepaid.
Amen. Prepaid.
And we're going to sing about the goodness of God. Let's sing together.
I love you, Lord. Oh, your mercy never fails me. All my days I've been held in your hands. From the moment that I wake up until I lay my head, I will sing of the goodness of God. All my life you have been faithful. All my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, I will sing of the goodness of God. I love your voice. You have led me through the fire. In darkest night, you are close like no other. I've known you as a father. I've known you as a friend. I have lived in the goodness of God. All my life you have been faithful. All my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, I will sing of the goodness of God. Your goodness is running after, is running after me. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. With my life laid down, I surrender now. It's running after, it's running after me. All my life you have been faithful. All my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, I will sing
the goodness of God. I will sing of the goodness of God. When peace like a
with your soul. go forth in peace. The love of God, the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the communion and power of the Holy Spirit be with you.